Okay, hi, hello. My name is Toria. I work on the search platform team at a company called Shopify. I've been specializing in search and information retrieval systems for about 4 years of my career. So I have a lot to say about search engines, but I'm gonna give you the basics in the next 15 minutes. So probably when you imagine or think about search engines, you're picturing something like this, or this, or this, or maybe even this one. But those are all web search engines. What they make searchable and available to you is the entire internet. Not all search engines are web search engines. If you think about it, pretty much every website or app you go to, which has sufficiently large amounts of data, need to make that data searchable, right? Etsy, Yelp, one of our sponsors today, they all have their own search bars on their website. That's not calling out to some Google API. They've implemented their own custom search. I would argue that probably most apps or websites have a custom search engine. Why would you do this? I sometimes get asked, why do you work on search? This is a solved problem. We have Google. Well, we have a smaller scope when we're just searching within our own content and our own data, right? So we have more control over the data. We can customize the priority that data is treated with, and that means we can extract from it better performance and give better quality results and a better quality experience to our users. And I hope that you're gonna see how all of this is true today as I teach you more about how search engines work and why you need them. So, best way to learn how something works, try to build it from scratch. So, we are going to imagine that I have a side gig. It's called Toria's Pet Emporium. It is a website where I sell costumes and clothing for pets. I made this website myself. I didn't, it's a Shopify site. But imagine that I did, then I probably would have made myself a database that looks something like this. All my items for sale, I've given them a title and a price, and then when I insert them into the database, they get assigned a unique ID in incremental order. So someone comes to my website, they want to buy something for their cat. Probably the first thing I would do to try to implement search is write a query like this. So this is SQL or structured query language, which is a really common way of talking to databases, and I'm gonna assume that most of you are familiar with it. The important part of this query is where title like percent cat percent. So percent is a wildcard match for string matching in SQL. So this means give me all the information you have about every record in the database where cat is a substring somewhere in the title string. Cool. So this is gonna find our three cat-related items, awesome. It's also gonna find this vacation hat for dogs because cat is a substring of vacation. It's also not gonna find item number 7, our kitten mittens, which arguably I might wanna return it. I want people to buy things. I want them to find things that are cat-related. Kitten mittens are cat-related. But we're gonna come back to those problems later. Let's say for now that this is good enough. The question is, how does it perform? I only have 8 items for sale today, but what happens when I have 8,000 or 8 million items for sale, or generally things I need to be searchable? So, big O notation, if you're not familiar with it, is a way that we describe the performance of an algorithm. We're trying to describe the growth of an algorithm as the size of the input changes. So every time n, the input data, the amount of input data we have doubles, does our algorithm get twice as slow as well? Does it stay the same speed? That's what big O is trying to achieve. So our search is roughly big O of n times m. So n is the number of records we have in our database. So we scan the entire database. We have to check every item to see if our substring is in there. And then m is the amount of time it takes to parse that string. So this is the length of the string. We have to scan, in the worst case, up to the whole thing to confirm whether or not our substring is there. So in practical terms, if we had a maximum string length for our title of about 250 characters, when we have only 10 items, 2,500 operations, computers are fast, that's not too bad. But if we had 1 million items for sale, 250 million operations, we're now in the seconds of clock time. We're now in the range where a user would have to wait entire seconds, like maybe 3 to 5 seconds for the results to come back. That's not acceptable to our users. So we need to do better. Let's look at the database again. The big reason this is slow is that we had to scan the entire thing. And the reason we had to scan the entire thing is it's not in a sort order that's meaningful to us. It's just in the order we inserted it in. It's in ID order. Now, you might remember from any database learning or classes you've taken that if you know the ID, you can pretty much just go find that whole record in, like, constant time. Single operation, you can find it. So you could think of a database like a map that maps from an ID as the key over to, say, our title string. So what if we flipped it on its head, and instead, we map from words or substrings that we care about to lists of IDs that contained those strings? This is called an inverted index, and it is the fundamental data structure behind every modern search engine. If there is one thing you remember today, it's this, inverted index. So now we're mapping from words or substrings to sets of IDs. So now when someone comes to my website and they search for cat, if I had an inverted index like this, it would be a simple lookup to the cat bucket, and there I found all of my cat-related items. This took O of one. It was a single operation. Now, I'm glossing over something important here, which is that we're not going to return to our user, like, we found items 1, 3, and 5 for you. They don't care. We have to go to the database and fetch all the information about the items. So you might call this O of R, where our algorithm actually scales with respect to the number of results we find, which is kind of interesting. But in practice, we probably only actually show the user some fixed number of results at a time, right? We give them, say, 25 at a time on a page, and this is considered effectively O of one as well. If it's a fixed number, we just call this constant time. So again, still seems a little too good to be true, and if your spidey sense is tingling about that, it's good and it's right. But the way that we achieved O of one is by making trade-offs. So the first one is we took up extra space, right? We took our database, we made this separate other data structure. We didn't get to get rid of the database. We have both. So we've approximately doubled the amount of information we have to store. We've also added a bunch of system complexity. By introducing this new system, our developers have to know about it, they have to know how to maintain it. Possibly it runs on separate servers, there's a network hop to get there, so we've made our system more complex. But most importantly and most interestingly, we had to do a bunch of pre-processing. Right, I really glossed over how we actually made that inverted index. So when we talk about the performance of a search engine, we talk separately about index time and query time. So up until now, we've been talking about query time. And we made query time really fast. That's what search engines are all about. You want to minimize query time at the expense of index time. So let's talk a little more about what actually happens at index time. How did we build that inverted index? First thing we did is called tokenization. So we took our string and we split it into words. In English, this is pretty simple. You can pretty much just tokenize on white space and punctuation. But as an exercise, I would love for you to think about how much harder this is in languages like German or Japanese, where we don't always have white space separating concepts or words. Next, we perform normalization, which has two major steps. The first one's called stemming. This is where we convert a word to its root form. So for example, a plural becomes singular, verb forms take on their infinitive, so this way we can treat all of those words as equivalent. They mean the same thing. We also remove stop words. Generally speaking, this is optional, you don't have to do this, but words like the, to, they don't really add value to our search, and a lot of our documents are gonna contain them, so we just remove them. We're just gonna skip them entirely. Next, we can optionally add some filters. So a really common filter we might wanna add is converting everything to lowercase. And if we convert everything to lowercase, this effectively makes our search case insensitive. Another one is synonyms. So for example, the Canadian and American spellings of color, we want those to be equivalent. If someone searches for color with a U, but we have an item in the database that has color without a U, we want them to still find it. So we can use synonyms to do that. You can also use synonyms to customize your results. So earlier I said that I would really love for people to be able to find my kitten mittens when they search for cat. So I could make kitten and cat a synonym. So this is where we paid the price of our fast query time. We're doing all of these things, and I'm not gonna go into detail about the actual performance metrics of each of them, because every time, every search engine that you make, you're gonna choose a different combination of these operations, maybe other ones that I didn't cover here, but this is what makes it slow. And one other thing I wanna cover before I move on for this slide is that all of these transformations that you apply to your input data, you have to apply the same transformations in the same order to the query that the user gave you. Otherwise, you're not gonna find the right stuff. So if I converted every reference to kitten into cats in the back end, and then someone searches for kitten, I have to make sure that I know that that also needs to be converted to cat. So up till now, we've mostly been talking about performance. Fast query time, slow index time, but I also want to cover quality, right? Earlier, we noticed we had some quality problems with our SQL query. So the first problem was that we returned this vacation hat for dogs because cat's a substring of vacation. And we didn't get back the kitten mittens, which I would like. Additionally, we didn't talk about this, but if someone had searched for cats with an S, our SQL query as we had written it would only find this one item because of that pesky S. Now you could try to solve it by writing an increasingly more complicated SQL query. Don't do this. this would be very slow and not performant. Like operations with wildcards are quite expensive. This is definitely not good. But instead, I'm going to show you how, while we were building that inverted index, all of these filters and techniques we were using to create the inverted index, we can sneak in a bunch of things that solve our quality problems. So we had to tokenize everything, and that immediately solves our cat and vacation problem because they're different tokens. Searching for cats is going to return all the items that just say cat because we bucketed them all into the same bucket due to stemming. And then now if I make sure that I apply my cat and kitten synonym filter, the kitten ID gets bucketed up there into cat, and now we've solved my cat-kitten problem as well. So let's summarize what we've learned so far. First of all, not all search engines are web search engines, and there are lots of reasons that you might want to build your own search engine for your own data. If you do this, you want to use a search engine rather than just trying to query your database because you can get way, way better performance out of it. Although we only talked about text search today, numerical search is a whole other lightning talk for another time. And we did this at the expense of taking up extra space, adding system complexity, and doing a whole bunch of pre-processing work at a stage that we call index time. And then finally, we saw that when we're building up our inverted index at index time, we can apply a bunch of things to improve the quality of our search results overall. Now, if I have convinced you that you might want to build a search engine for your project or your application, you might be wondering, do I have to build it myself? And of course the answer is no. There are open source tools available for you. The main two are called Solr and Elasticsearch. There are lots of open source search engines out there, but these are the two by far most popular ones. And they're both built on top of the same underlying library called Lucene. So Lucene is what implements that inverted index that we saw. And then Solr and Elasticsearch sit on top and turn Lucene into a real production system. So it runs on separate servers, it accepts API calls, you can replicate and shard your data, you can do things like caching and warming to get better performance out of it. So what you really want are one of Solr and Elasticsearch. You might be wondering, but which one? Objectively, they are both capable of performing equally as well. People have tried to prove that one outperforms the other for certain types of data. Every time when one search engine greatly outperformed the other, it turned out to be a configuration error. So get to know your configuration files. But if you would like a little bit of my personal opinion injected in here, I think that Solr's plugin system is a lot better. I think that if this is a long con, if you're working at a big company that's planning on investing over years and years into your search, and you might want to build custom request handlers and custom field types, you might want to invest in Solr. But Elasticsearch is way easier to get up and running for the first time. It's easier to work with if you've never used search engines before. And frankly, I find their documentation more accessible, has more practical examples. So for most cases, I recommend Elasticsearch. And that's all. Thank you so much for your time.